Today we are going to talk about storytelling. Okay, I don't know if you have had some other notions of storytelling, maybe in principles of animation, in designing for entertainment and play, designing for user experience, in different modules. So probably you might already have some kind of idea. We are going to try to, like they say in this Buddhist sentence, try to forget whatever you know, so we can learn something. Okay. So let's also talk about some elements of structure, basically. And tomorrow and the Thursday, we are going to try to see how this links to the assignment. I was thinking that I don't know if I started to record this. Oh yeah, I did. Okay. Okay, so let's see. At this point, you should already have some kind of idea, because remember that in the first weeks I gave you the idea of your assignment, so you should know already what is your animation about. Okay, we have seen examples of character design, practice character design. We have been practicing techniques, okay? So right now, these 2 weeks, what you should focus is on be sure that you know what or how to transmit, to communicate all the information you have about your concept of the story. And also be sure that you can frame them in a specific timeline, okay? 60 seconds or more, that is your story supposed to be, okay? Then in relation to the storyboards, you know, you have materials. Next week is when we are going to work on a storyboard. My advice is not to let the storyboard for the last minute. So tomorrow we are going to practice the story and the storyboard as well. Okay, and hopefully you will be okay for the deadline. Okay, I understand the deadline is a little soon, but the problem with this is that I couldn't make that to be later and still have some kind of month between assignments. And for me, it was very important to have a month between assignments because I wanted to give you feedback on the first assignment before you did the second assignment. So for me, it was important that there were always a gap of more than a month between assignments. And that is why they told me that the deadline need to be on that one, okay, on the 19th December, November, which is slightly soon, okay. It should be better after, but well, this year it is what it is, okay. Still, you have 2 weeks, so hopefully you have time to deliver something, okay, some good products. I don't know, okay. Some advice in relation to production. Well, it might be interesting to identify the processes, identify the time you are spending in the parts of the process just for you, just to be organized in this sense. This is extremely important when you start animating, okay, to define clearly how much time you are spending in each scene, in each shot, in each action, okay, so you can roughly calculate if you will be okay to do the 60 seconds, okay? You don't want to do an animation of, you know, 20 seconds or whatever and then just reproduce that, you know, 3 times slower. That is not how it works. So you need to plan properly your work in relation to the whole project. So that is why sometimes it's useful to use this kind of assets. This is an Excel template in case you want to have a look, okay? So first of all, I would like to explore some of the ideas you have about the storytelling, okay? So I don't know if you have any kind of definition or any kind of, idea of what differentiates a product when it has narrative, when it has a story, and when it hasn't. What ideas do you have about this? Is anybody willing to share points of view about narrative? correction? No? The question, okay. There are products that are narrative, or they are, you know, forms of storytelling, no? If you don't understand something because of any language issue or because I don't explain myself properly, just let me know. But yeah, I mean, not every kind of video or any kind of, you know, graphic story or any kind of message, it's narrative. Not everything is narrative. There will be some elements, so there will be some forms of narration, some forms of communication that are narrative, that are storytelling, and some of them aren't. Okay, so how you split the ones that are narrative from the ones that aren't. Is that clear? Is that pen line? Is it the bear from line? But from line. Line, the message?
What?
Line, the messenger?
Line, the message, what?
Line is an application messenger, a mobile application. No, line? You don't know line?
No.
Really? It's super famous. It's, I don't know, it's...
Line.
Line. This one? Line? This one? Is that one?
Oh, yeah, I get to use that.
Okay. I'm not a total failure as a lecturer. I teach something to someone today. Yeah, totally useless, but still I teach something. Okay. Well, yeah, it's interesting because that application is like a messenger, and I studied that in a paper I did in a conference in Manchester, and it was like my point was how this application use narrative settings, okay? And it was related to this in the sense that there is fictionality, but when fictionality becomes narrative? And that is my question again. There are things that are real, things that are fictional, but still, what is narrative and what is not narrative? Really? So, you see news or whatever. For example, of course you don't see news, but imagine that you go to YouTube and you watch an interview or something. Are interviews narrative?
You mean like they made up?
What?
You mean like, is it like made up?
No, that would be if they are fictional. You know, if they are real or not. Narrative would be, are they,
but they swear the
communicating a story?
No.
What?
They swear the narrative, the news?
Do they refer to a narrative because maybe they are talking about a movie or they are talking about a song or there are
maybe
narrative elements?
Maybe they're talking about story and
the mind. Well, storytelling has to do with stories and narrative has to do with stories, so more or less. The thing is, when a video, a communication, a piece of information acquires the structure of a narrative, is it a question of a structure? Is it a question of purpose? Is it a question of, you know, what features have the message to be considered storytelling? Well, let's see an example. This one was the Halloween from last year, and it was, I don't know if you see that, it's an animation. It was the doodle of last year, and I selected this because I think it's a very classical story, okay? So there is no doubt for me that there is a story here. And this is clear in terms of a structure. Well, we are going to see this and then we can talk. Okay, I hate the frog with the hate that. But I like the cat. Thank you. Okay. So, what I, my point here in relation to this is, what differentiates a message from a message where there is a narrative, okay, is that the people involved in this communication process, okay, the audience, the readers, the gamers, the, you know, whatever, it depends on the media we are using, they have to be able to understand some elements. And when I'm saying understand, I'm making implicit that there are elements of style, the elements of form, and elements of content. And it's not that easy sometimes to differentiate content and style. This is the typical Platonic issue of form versus content. And we are not going to enter on that. It's not that really important. It is about, did you understand that here there is someone who wants something and there will be obstacles in the way? These are the basic elements all stories need to have. Whatever the story, it's happy or it's a sad ending, or whatever it is, a complex story, there are more than one character, or there are several stories combined, or there is, you know, there will be thousands of possibilities, but in all cases, you can identify clearly a subject, okay, a main character, in this case, which would be, let's do the Dora the Explorer thing. This one, the character is banana. Sorry, the ghost. And what do the little ghost want?
Friendship,
friends. Okay, whatever it is, like an object, feeling, emotions. But yeah, it might be something. Whatever it is, something complex. Or not complex, it needs to be translated to something that you as an audience understand. So we are assuming that everybody knows what our friends and can share emotions with the little ghost. Okay? So the story could be different, could be something like, oh, I want to be the best ghost ever. That would be like a manga. Or it would be like more kind of, ah, there is a concert and I want to be in the concert because that way everybody's going to see how will I sing, blah blah blah. Well, that might be slightly different, but at the end of the day it will have to do with similar stuff: recognition, social rewarding, okay, emotions. Okay, so someone wants something, in this case kind of very specific, okay, and then there will be obstacles on the way. The main obstacle is derived in this case from the very same nature of the character. Okay, so you define properly a character, you are defining well the limitations and the skills. Okay, so in this case this character has some kinds of limitations, which at the end of the day seems to be just kind of lack of self-confidence or something like that, no? Because he discovers that at the end of the day being himself makes him to. So this is the other thing you can learn today, you know, to be yourself. You know, so don't say that you don't learn things in principles of animation. Okay, so being yourself, okay? If you think about that, all stories needs to be understood this way. And this is basically just the ABC of what the storytelling is. But if you really learn this today, I will be more than happy. Okay, it's the only thing I want. Someone wants something, but there will be obstacles on the way. Again, this is like the, you know, the Bible when it says love and do whatever you want. Yeah, but if you love, you cannot kill. And if you love, you cannot steal, you know, because you love, and, you know, so it's kind of that. So here you have like the someone, it can entail a lot of things. It needs to be well defined. It cannot be confused. It needs to be clearly identified who is the character. Okay, so it doesn't, it's just someone wants something. No, who is? Okay, sometimes what you have in a story is someone who wants something, and then the other people that want exactly the same. Okay, this is a narrative, it's called narrative program. So you say you have a narrative program and the enemies, the villains, have the opposite narrative program. Let's say, for example, I don't know if you know Indiana Jones or things like that, no? Like there is an object and everybody chasing the object, so the good guys chase the object and the bad guys chase the same object, no? So there will be a narrative program and then there will be the opposite narrative program, okay? It doesn't really matter. The important thing is everybody needs to know what the people is pursuing or what the people is chasing. I mean, sometimes, I don't know, you've seen these new movies like Star Wars, like the new one, or Rogue One, and all this. Sometimes they commit the mistakes that they are like chasing stuff and you don't really get to identify what they are pursuing or for what it is, you know. In narrative, there was something called MacGuffin. I don't know if you have heard about that, MacGuffin. It's a concept. It's defined by Hitchcock, this British filmmaker, and he was commented that it's not important what's the object, it's for. But it's very important that everybody knows that the characters want that object, okay? So, for example, if you go to Star Wars, you have like the maps of the location of Luke Skywalker. What is, if you start to think about that, it's all stupid. It's kind of, what? The map of where the other is? It doesn't really matter, but it moves the narration. It moves the story, and that's the important thing, the function and the structure, okay? So the things needs to have that kind of inner logic in terms of a structure and function, and that is why they work, okay? So someone wants something. What is it important? Why is it important? If you work on these concepts, okay, the story would work better, but at least it needs to be very clear that something is chasing. Don't think always in the concept of some object, physical object that everybody is pursuing. It doesn't have to be like that. It could be like in this case, something like more emotional, like kind of social recognition, like, I don't know. Oh, I'm trying to put a nail on the wall. And if it's me, maybe it's not very funny, but imagine it's Donald Duck trying to nail a... And you can imagine, if you really know Donald Duck or anything, any character like that, you would understand this is something to be finally very, very funny. Something is going to happen, so he cannot finally nail the nail, okay? Cannot, you know, nail on the wall, okay? So, I don't know. I mean, it's just a stupid example, but the important thing is you have these elements well-defined, okay? Obstacles on the way. If my goal is to, if my goal is just to allocate a frame on the wall, and I just got the hammer, the nail on the wall, and put the frame, what is the story? If you want to do a story, there must be a challenge. There must be an obstacle, okay? So you need to define that. And in this case, as I say before, with the cost, is kind of the his or her lack of confidence or whatever, okay, or prejudice or physical appearance or whatever. Again, obstacles could be people, could be emotional circumstance, it could be many things, okay? Everything is there, working then later in different levels, okay? Three acts structure, it's a kind of Aristotelian, it's called Aristotelian because it is supposed to be coming from Aristotle's, okay, so that makes almost 2000 years of history of social science, so it's a lot. So the thing is, even in the 90s, they were speculating if all the movies and even video games should work following this structure, which you know perfectly is the common structure of beginning, middle, and end, okay? Presentation, conflict, resolution, just that. But this setup, confrontation, resolution is not really that simple. You have other elements there, okay? Other moments in the history that this kind of forces, this kind of directions, this kind of programs, narrative programs, confront. Okay, the most clear, I mean, not always that easy to identify, but the most clear is the climax. But where is the climax? Is the moment where you will, whatever it happens in the climax, you as an audience would know if this is getting or not, if this character is getting or not the object or the state that he is chasing. So what is the climax in the history of the in the story of the little ghost? Yeah, and you see like the face of the little cat,
yeah.
And you have some kind of suspense. No, there is kind of feeling that you don't know exactly what is going to happen. So intentionally, the filmmakers are extending that, so you are in that moment of tension, and then there is a resolution. Okay, the resolution is a happy ending in this case. Even continue it when you have the Google Doodle, because you see like pictures, no, of that they are friends, long term or whatever. Who knows how that's work? No? But yeah, that is the climax. Okay. So that is important. When you have, and that is this scalability, it's very important to understand. You have the same elements in a 90-minute story that you have in a 90-second story. But what you have is elements of scalability. So when you have a longer arc, okay, you have that very same nature of confrontation between desire and resolution, but in every of the acts. Okay. For example, in 90 minutes movies, you have something that is the change of the mission in the second in the second turning point, that is called. But this is another kind of stories. But still, is working in 1, 2, and 3 acts. And in that moment, where you know, have you seen, for example, Jaws? That movie, there is a shark, a giant shark, and they have to follow that. Okay, so so you have a mission. The mission is to find this shark. Okay, but then that mission doesn't really start at the very beginning of the movie. It starts in the second part of the movie. So it's kind of, you get that story and you get like a whole different movie. Okay, that is the second turning point. Okay, and usually it works in many movies when you are more than 90 minutes long. Okay, you have a story, and in a moment, everything is presented, so now the story is this other. For example, in all superheroes movies, you will have always presentation of the character, blah, 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 and when you acquire the powers. And so in a moment, then everything is sorted out. You have your powers, you have your skills. Now the mission is you have to fight this villain, the villain of this movie. No? So there will be a new story, okay? So it means that the story can be read as a three-act structure, but then later there are, arcs within each act. Okay, it's just that. Another concept interesting to understand in terms of narrative is the difference between plot and story. Okay, this is very simple to understand. When you go to movies like crime story, crime TV shows, like CSI, scientific forensic. No, I don't know if there is now something on TV similar to that, or is there any thriller thing that you see now? Do you watch any TV? I mean, streaming TV. You know? I don't know what TV show is about police nowadays. Is there something? Which one?
Y5O,
what is that?
NCS.
Yeah, well, NCS, all these follow the same structure. Now, I was thinking if there was any example, you know, like from the last year or from the last 2 years, because I don't know. I'm watching TV, but I don't know.
Crime show.
Which one?
Crime show.
crime scene investigation is the classical one, but they have done like 6 series of that. Mm-hmm. But the last one is at least 4 years old. So that is why I'm saying if there was any modern example. But oh yeah, for example, How to Get About Murder. That is not too old. So you get one thing, it's the plot, and the other is the story. What is the story? Someone killed another person, and then months later, this bunch of university people or whatever, they talk about that thing. But that is the plot. Sorry, that's the story. It's order in the natural order. Natural order. I am a killer, I decide to kill someone, I kill someone. Me or it's a figure of speaking. So, and just that. That is the story. It has to be natural, it has to be logical. Okay, but the plot, no, the plot, it hasn't had to be like that. The plot can be anything you want. If you want, you can start the plot 3 minutes before the killing and showing the motivations of the little child that it was killed. And then you the audience can think, ah, so the story is about the child. And then the audience think, ah, no, the story is not about the child. The child is dead, so it's not about her anymore. You know, so obviously the story is changing because one thing is the plot and the other is the story. The plot is the presentation of the facts. Okay, the story is the real, the reality. Okay, so then it is represented in particular events. Okay, these events can be or not shown, can be or not displayed. Okay, so you have to decide which ones are more representative. Okay, it doesn't change the fact that there is a story that you tell or not some things. Okay, so sorry to be eschatologic, but how many people do you remember being in the bathroom? Being on a movie, not many, but we know that they be, they for sure they be. That doesn't make you think something about that. There was a movie with Stanley Kubrick and Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman, and she is Nicole Kidman and she is fabulous because she is Nicole Kidman before the Botox, and still she is being, you know. So that's a very interesting, you know, event to reflect. But as I say, not everything needs to be reflected, no? So we select which things. How we select it and we order them with a timeline. So what do you have to have for your story? A timeline. Okay, that is the important thing. A timeline. In the second 13 is going to happen this. In the second 5 is going to happen this. Okay. Order all the events of the story, okay, so you can animate later and define your storyboard based on that timeline. Just a reflection about characters. You, as any postmodern audience, members of the audience, you will be more related usually with serial narratives, like TV shows. This is from the Walking Dead, no? It's comic books or sitcoms or whatever. Usually in serial narratives you have something called Bible. Have you heard about that? It's Bible, but not with caps. It's not the Bible, it's Bibles, and it's just a document that reflects all the information about the character. So that way when the different teams are working on Superman or working on this TV show, they should go to the Bible, and the Bible is telling you the things that we know about the character. So for example, do you know this series? Have you seen this? So do you remember this character, Sheldon Cooper? Or what do we know about it? What? Bazinga. Bazinga? But we don't know exactly what, you don't know, or you know what Bazinga is? You know? Yeah, but the meaning or whatever, I mean, no? No, you don't. You're not sure about that. What is this from, no? No, come on. There must be a reason he say that. I don't know, might be a bad example. Where is he from?
Texas.
How many sisters does he have? One sister and one brother. No? Does he have a father? has a mother which is very religious. So all these things are part of this world, and this world is believable because it has kind of logic that you have already constructed, ordered, and connected. And the way you know about that is because someone did the Bible, and then in different episodes they were, and showing and covering all these aspects. Okay, so it is a well-writing character, supposedly. Okay, I don't know if there will be maybe some analysis of, I didn't do a very good analysis of this, so I don't know, maybe someone can find that it's not a very good one. But if you go to the best series ever, always have a very detailed construction of characters. I mean, probably the best example is, what is this series? Breaking Bad. If you have seen that, it's, you might like it more. I don't like it especially, but you have to admit that it has a very coherent construction of characters. It's all very well designed. It all makes very much logic. Okay. Serial characters are different. If you are familiar with manga, anime, or this obviously my kind of my topic, the logic here is different. They are masters in Japanese anime industries in creating visual designs. For example, this guy from Bleach, this Tite Kubo. I don't know if you have you seen this series? Has anybody seen? It's on Netflix. There's a live action, but forget about that. Just go to the anime or the manga better. The thing is, these four people are quite detailed. They're telling you, oh, has no sense of rhythm. This one is called Hawk. I mean, how much time do they appear on the series? Two panels. So in a series of 80 volumes, for a character that shows up in two panels, you have that kind of characterization. Okay? So create background on your stories to a certain limit. I don't want you to, elaborate on. But, you know, if you define clearly your character, it's going to have some presence. It's going to be believable, okay? Whatever believable is in a world that is, you know, the people with Jean Schwartz and all this, I mean, to a certain extent, okay? So, who created ideas? And I'm going to elaborate much on this because you have already the idea and you should have already developed a kind of concept related to the concept I gave you weeks ago. No? Are you okay with that? More or less? Yeah? Okay. Different ways of, without accessing to drugs, the ways of getting ideas are based on your own experience, okay? And then working on characters. Think for example in serial narratives, okay? If you create a good character, like a superhero, it's going to last 60 years. But honestly, it might not be your way. I mean, you don't need to create a character that is going to last 60 years. You just need to create a character that is going to work in that story, okay? If it then happens to be good enough and you can do more things with it, happy. I mean, so sure that you would find that very useful, but it's not the point. The point is, it is working on the structure of the story. That is what you should be thinking of, okay? So, working on themes, okay? Sometimes you can have an approach like problem solution, okay? Something like, I would like to do a story. For example, when I was writing short films and all this, I did so many years of that. I remember that we have some kind of challenges like that. So we have idioms, and we wanted to create the stories based on idioms. So when you say, you know, like for example, the early bird catches the worm, and we wanted to create a story based on that idiom. So we try to figure out a story, and not necessarily is a bird that gets the worm. It could be, but it doesn't have to. Okay, so things like that. So there's a problem, you formulate the problem, you try to use the narrative as a way to create the solution for that problem. Okay, or experimenting. Okay, things like, do you know the this um, the what is the dice is Rory's dice. Have you played to that? Well, there are even websites about that. So there are dices that has different icons like draws. So you just roll the dice, and depending on the dice you get, you can then play to have a story. It's priorities in life. Okay, so intertextuality. Okay, very common. Not for a coincidence. I used this on the first. No, it's an intertextuality. Have you seen the Neverending Story? So this thing that looks like a dog or something like that is a dragon, supposedly. And the Family Guy is, you know, playing with the dragon. So it's obviously a storyteller. There is an intertextuality there, no? Okay, very common in all these series like Family Guy or South Park or this kind of parodies. They are based in the intertextuality. We are going to do an episode about Pokemon. We are going to do an episode about Warcraft or things like that. Have you seen the episode of Pokemon of South Park? It's the best episode ever. It's called Team Pokemon. And everybody wants to have one. And it's like, oh, Team Pokemon, you have to get them all. Team Pokemon. It's super fun. So you have to have a look at that. Okay. Again, typical of manga, but to certain extent apply to all animation industries. Charismatic characters are based in very clear features. If you cannot differentiate your character from another, and there is two characters and are similar, there is something wrong on this. But what can happen in a movie, if you are, well, you know, that if you are from a certain ethnic group and you are watching a movie of another certain ethnic group, you might have problems differentiating characters. For example, if I see a Chinese movie, I might have problems, or a Japanese or whatever. Or if a Japanese is watching an Indian movie, it might have problems differentiating the different actors. That is a psychological effect, okay? But we cannot do that in animation, okay? In animation, hi, hello, can we, yeah. In animation, all characters needs to be unique, needs to have a very clear personality, and needs to be very well defined, okay? Unless it is intentional or whatever, okay? This is just an example of another kind of construction where you do constructions based on semiotics. What is semiotics? The science of meaning. So you have the possibility of work as well with oppositions or contradictions. Okay, opposition and contradiction is not the same. Contradiction could be, well, here's a contradiction, no? Complex cannot be simple, okay? But what is simple and easy are not the same, okay? So these two are contrary, but not contradictory, okay? So contradictory and contrary, okay, it's just that. It's basic on semiotics. Why you do these type of things? Because sometimes working on pure concepts give you the key of developing narrative programs, okay? On developing different motivations for your characters, for example. Creating two characters that are opposite because they belong to different semiotic elements, okay? For example, when you have a character that is a villain and the other is the good guy, they are working in contradictory terms, okay? So maybe you create one to be shy, the other talks too much, okay? Or you create, so you construct based on opposition or contradiction different features of your characters because it makes sense to a semiotic level, okay? You don't have to do it, it's just another technique, okay? Not all works work like that. Another approach could be allegories. Okay, it's again allegory is it's related more with the cultural studies. The thing is, it's easy when you see the Lion King, and you know that the Lion King was done in 1997, and you can think, oh, because it was in 1997, this was and many studies about that. This is the representation of an Arab character. Okay, so Arabs are political enemies of the American citizens. Okay, they are some to certain extent they are demonized. So the way they understand this is, okay, we can do a character that has some features that are belonging to this. Okay, but as I say, it's easy when you do cultural studies to do this interpretation to an a prioristic form. That when it's done, okay, now I think, okay, I'm going to interpret this movie this way, but it doesn't mean necessarily that this was intentional. It might be intentional or not, okay? Allegory, anyway, it's constructed on, and it's part of the semiotics as well, it's constructing on elements of symbolic meaning, okay? So, well, this girl, this lady, it's opposed to Ariel. So Ariel is beautiful, what do you know Ariel? It's one of my favorite princes, I have to say that. Red hair. Okay. What else? Silent. She's not silent at all. The one has a beautiful voice, she has an awful voice. One is beautiful. She's very, she might be friendly, I don't know. But she's so beautiful. Colors, opposed colors. Blue, red. Okay? So work with different contrasting elements when you construct your characters. Everything, it's part of those semiotics, okay? Also in color codes. So the problem solution, well, here is the architecture as we have defined it. This is an interesting concept. This was applied in the 90s to movies, like blockbusters movies. There was if a movie can be defined with a very clear sentence, with a very clear concept, okay, then it has the ability to be transformed into different things. So these things are part of the story, but are not other products. Let's specify that. You create the concept of, and I think all the Pixar movies work very well on these high concepts, on Nemo, and it's about the sea. The simulation of sea, lights, textures, colors, okay? Then you select an anemone, which is this kind of, environment, this kind of, seaweed, okay? And then what does it live here? This kind of, what is the name of this? Pierrot, is it Pierrot? Fish? Clownfish, Pierrot, yeah, sorry. No, in Spanish is payaso, nothing to do with Spanish. I think it was because it was the Latin name, anyway. You have here that species of fish, so everything is related to that, no? So you define the character. Character is one of the elements of the high concept. Other elements. Genre. It has to be a comedy, okay? Naturally associated to that, okay? Music, okay? Actors involved. I don't know which actors are involved, but needs to be also part of this group of actors from Disney. Okay, it has to be a family voice. Okay, so all is in the package. So all these elements are working together to construct the movie. Okay, if the high concept is clearly stated, all elements of the movie, like the music, like the advertising, like the actors, like the genre, like the like character, okay, all of them are going to work together to communicate the story, okay. Better examples of this are Pixar movies, okay. So let's go to the most basic thing. You need to define a timeline, okay. And if you have a timeline of 90 seconds, it would be midpoint, 45, and obviously the other 45 would be between the beginning and the end. So if you have 60 seconds, okay, you would need to create a story where the confrontation, the elements of, you know, where it is clearly and explicitly stated how the characters want something and what are the obstacles, okay? So there is no presentation, there is no, for example, description of the initial state or the initial world or whatever. That is just for the beginning. So if you have 60 seconds, how much should be the middles, the mid? It's 30 seconds, okay? So if the mid one is the half, approximately, you have 60 seconds, it means 30 seconds, 15 and 15. Okay? 15, 30, 50. Is that clear? Okay? So when do you have to arrive to the climax? In the 45 seconds. No? So it's approximately, okay? At the beginning or at the end of the second act. Or maybe, you know, any point being 40 seconds. This is not that mathematical, but it's kind of, at the end of the day, the decisions about the climax and about the characters, and all, they have to be reflected on the structure. Okay, we can create a story and reflect about all these elements and about all this interaction, but at the end, it needs to be on the timeline, okay? So, I don't know where I did this. Ah, that's better times, I like that. And, well, okay, writing in animation, it's not that easy when we have talked about this, when you are on your own, to have that kind of a structure, like if you were an industry. So you, I cannot expect from you some that level of sophistication. But my idea is at least that you should know that at the same time that you're working with character design, you should have in mind the storyline. How we reflect the storyline? Through a storyboard. Okay, so very simple. What is the most important? Have a good storyboard. Okay, these are vocabulary that is related to what a story is. You don't need that. If you have any question in relation to assignment, we can have a look together to the description. But basically, what you need in the assignment is the storyboard and the concept. No, the concept can be stated as an idea, but I guess that the best way to explicit a concept is a plot. Because if you say an idea, it could be like sometimes a premise. Like for example, what happens if you are locked in an elevator with a psycho killer and an alarm and a cake? Well, okay, so you are in an elevator with this. That is a premise. But the plot would be Manuel arrives to the elevator, then finds there is a clown, psycho killer clown, and a lamb and a cake. Okay, and then this is an improvisation, so I don't remember. So I can't think now what can be an end for that. So then, what? Yeah, there's a lamb, a clown, and a cake, and I enter in the elevator. See, yeah, a psycho killer clown, a lamb, and a cake. Yeah. Yeah, it's a lamb, like bear. Yeah. Could be. The plot could be something like that. Manuel enters in the elevator with these individuals, and then there is a electrical cut or break or whatever. And then when the lights are on, something has happened. No? So the plot doesn't have to be the story. You know? And then when the lights are on, the only people alive is the lamp. You know? So that would be the plot. The story. The story needs to be clearly enough through the plot. Okay, the people need to see the plot and understand the story. But the story is not the plot, remember, okay? So the concept, the best way of expressing the concept, a plot. The plot needs to be very clear, needs to correspond to 1 minute of narration, and during the plot, it needs to be very stated, all the things we have talked about narrative. Like, there is a character, there are emotions, the character is well defined, there are contrapositions, there are all these things, okay? I understand that the narrative is something complicated. I mean, I studied, I did a PhD on this. There are many theories, there are many approaches, there are many books. I don't expect you to understand them all today, but at least the very basics of what narrative is this, okay? Is being able to communicate through a plot, okay, and through a timeline, using some events, this kind of structures and functions, okay? So I would just have a look at this, okay? But this relation to animation is important to talk in things like stereotyping, okay? So for example, I had an exercise a couple of years ago, not this year because we changed the first lesson, but I had this as a, if you want to do a pirate, you do, what do you do? How do you know someone is a pirate? What?
Eye patch.
Eye patch, and maybe a parrot, and maybe a... or bootleg, no, or something like that. So, these are elements of stereotyping, okay? Just a comment, be careful with this, okay? Because a couple of years ago, there was someone, who did I didn't know. Be careful, okay, with the stereotyping, not creating messages that can offend to anybody, okay? So, with this, basically, we are done. Have a look at the sources. Most of them are ebooks, so you can get them from the library. Reading about narrative is something that is going to be fun and it's going to enrich your perspective in other modules, so I would always recommend that.